Father God, we come to you right now in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father God, for your love. We thank you, Father God, for your grace and your mercy. Lord Jesus, we love you. Continue to teach us how to follow you the right way. And the more and more we begin to realize that you love us, it will help us to love you more. By being obedient to your word and by being in love with our fellow men and brothers and sisters. We just thank you. No other God but you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, Lord. You had compassion on us. We love you, Lord Jesus. Now I submit myself to you, Father God, spirit, soul, and body. Use my mind, use my heart, use my mouthpiece to minister your word to your people this day. And we covenant with you right now, Father God, to give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory for every victory that will come out of today's session. We thank you, Father God, in Jesus' name. All who heard that prayer, say amen. Amen and amen. I want you to turn your Bibles, where is that at, Lord? To the book of Matthew. Matthew.
Come on, what are you doing? No, it's not how I want it.
Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9. Oh, so yeah, I thought it was 127. We're still in the same teaching mode, Fall in love with Jesus. That's gonna be the whole thing for this year. And we started with Matthew chapter 27, I heard you out there, talking about the crucifixion, because that's where it all started at. That's really where, as far as New Testament believers, But the stories that Jesus lived out, because remember, when Jesus showed up, when he was born in a manger of a virgin woman, Jesus was still under the old covenant. Y'all get that right? The old covenant had not passed out yet. Now the old covenant, as we know now, it was Judaism. That's what they called it. It was predominantly for Jews only. And the only way you could become a Jew, that's if under the old covenant, one, through birth, of course, and then two, if you become a proselyte, where you actually was following another god, and you did all those stuff, and you realized that, hey, I have to denounce my god, which the gods are doing, of course, in the old days. It was just like it is now. It had so many different religions at that time, just like it is now. And Baal was one of the other ones, was one of the more powerful ones that the religious world came up with. You know, Muslims, they were in that conversation. They was just starting to come about during the course of those days. But there are so many other different religions that was going on. You had the religion of the Roman Empire. You had, the pharaohs. They actually thought they were gods. Once you became a pharaoh, a regular old man, they thought they were gods. Really did. And, but God came in. He showed up. He showed up through Elisha. Elisha, he was by himself, and he was one of the main priests, not priests, prophets. Forgive me, Lord. I'm teaching this out. He was one of the main prophets of that time, and there was a whole bunch of religious people. They had to get their gods, and they had a big God challenge. And God, he said, you do your howling and howling and on the altar, and if the altar gets set on fire or gets on full of water, whatever, then that'll be your God. And here Elijah is, he watched them jokers make a bunch of noise, and then hear Elijah. He called to God one time, and God struck fire to the altar. It's a cool story. You go read it. But those gods were around when Jesus showed up as a baby. And the religious crowd who had Judaism or the Old Covenant, they had Judah and the Old Covenant, they had began to religiousize it so much so that you couldn't even see God in it anymore. You couldn't even see God. Now there was a few people that held hold to the truths and the teachings of what Moses had taught, had passed down through the Old Covenant. But the religious people of that day, there was only a few of them who were, they stayed in the sect because they didn't want to be considered as an outcast. We saw Nicodemus, he was like one of those Pharisees. He didn't want to be considered an outcast, but he knew the other people, they were falling away from God quickly, fast. And it was a big uproar. Now here Jesus showing up. God's commandments were still God's commandments. Period. Thus saith the Lord, thou shalt not. Thus saith the Lord, thou shalt not. Ten commandments. All those commandments plus 600 other different types of different things that was God, Jesus had in the Father. Jesus showed up, born of a virgin, of the Holy Ghost. He had to live out the Old Testament. He had to live it out. He had to live it out. And once he lived it out, because he says it himself in the book of Matthew, we're going to get to that in the days to come, that the Old Testament could not pass away until all be fulfilled. Adam was a representation for all mankind. Since Adam was a representation for all mankind, everybody in, because God had to see everybody in Adam commit sin, even though everybody had not committed sin yet, God had to see it that way. Why? So when Jesus showed up on the scene, and then he became the representation for all mankind as people who never committed sin. I'm going to say it again because I know some of y'all just missed that. God saw Adam, even though we were in the loins of Adam. We were in his genetic code. God had to see us that way. Why? Because Adam committed sin. When he committed sin, he had to see us in Adam's DNA as committing sin just like Adam, or in other forms, and we're going to read the scriptures here in a second, or in other forms, and he saw all of mankind fall. So when Jesus showed up, God saw all mankind in Jesus as in obtaining righteousness from God, lifting every man, woman, boy, or girl, and reconciling them back to God. Watch it. Matthew chapter 9. I'm doing more preaching than I am teaching. And so I don't want to be preaching too much. So look what it said. Matthew chapter 9. Come on. Matthew chapter 9. Look at verse 35. No, let's look at it. Look at verse 31. But they, when they were departed, spread abroad his fame. No, okay. Yeah, his fame. Because if you go, I'm coming in on the middle of a story. It will be in your best interest to go read the rest of the chapter. Because here Jesus, he was doing exactly what he was called to do. And the Pharisees, the religious crowd who was holding on to Judaism or the Old Covenant, they was teaching it the wrong way for so long. And now here Jesus is living the Old Covenant out, because he lived it to perfection. That's why we can say that he never committed one sin. That's why scripture says he never committed one sin. Why? Because he obeyed God to perfection as far as the Old Covenant was concerned. He never disobeyed not one minute or one second or one letter or one syllable of what the Old Testament said. He never committed one thing. So now here Jesus is living his stuff out, and the religious folk started trying to beat him down for him. And it said, but when they were departed, spread abroad his fame in all that country. As they went out, behold, they brought to him a dumb man possessed with a devil. And when the devil was cast out, the dumb spake, and the multitude marveled, saying, it was never so seen in Israel. But the Pharisees said, he casts out devils through the what? Prince of devils. No, they're trying to discredit Jesus. And Jesus went about all the cities and villages doing what? Teaching in their synagogues, and doing what?
Preaching
the gospel of the kingdom. And what? Healing. Three things: teaching, preaching, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was what? Moved with compassion on them, because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having what? No shepherd. See, the Pharisees were supposed to be preaching and teaching and casting out the devils, but they weren't getting the job done. Preaching, teaching, and casting out devils. Why? Because he looked on them, he was what? Moved with compassion. Moved. Your love should prompt you to go help somebody. Right here in this little area of Florida we live at, we see people constantly living on the streets. Constantly. Somebody needs to be preaching to them and teaching them that they don't have, come on man, you need to get on back up. It's sad to see some people, they choose to want to stay out there on the street. I ain't just talking about give them some food and give them some money or give them some clothes. What's going on in that person's mind to where they don't even want to get back up into society anymore? They don't want to get themselves off the street. Is it a devil holding them down? Is it bad preaching? Is some religious person or some religious crowd taught them that, hey, I've actually ran up into them. We were trying to talk to one lady, and she thinks God is literally trying to crucify her as she stands. And this thing in my head, like, no, that's God loves you. No, God doesn't. She told me, she said, God doesn't love me. I'm like, Jesus paid the price. And I wanted to reach out and grab and like shake her like, no, God loves you. What is Jesus doing? He went about preaching, teaching, and healing. Some people, they need a healing in their mind, not just a healing in their body. They need their mind to be completely healed. Completely healed. Why? Why? Because they did not have a shepherd. Then saith he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth laborers into the harvest. Here I am, I'm believing that God is sending people into the harvest. Lord, I'm a laborer. Use me, Lord. Use me. Use me, Lord. Show me what it is that I need to do, what I need to say to the people, because they don't have a shepherd. That they need somebody to teach them your word. They need somebody to preach the gospel to them of the kingdom. That, hey, in the meat we're talking about already, in the kingdom there is no lack. In the kingdom there is no sickness. In the kingdom there is no disease. In the kingdom there is no frustration. In the kingdom there is no confusion. There is peace. Nothing missing, nothing broken. There's prosperity. Don't just think prosperity of money. If you got $20 million in the bank, and your wife cheating on you, and you know she cheating on you, and you trying to love her, you don't have prosperity. If you got a husband and you say you get, like, I got this big time company, or I got me a nice job, and I don't need no man, it is God the one who said that you should be a helpmeet to your spouse, to your husband. God is the one who said that. I didn't come up with those words. No other man counted those words. God said that. Your husband cheating on you, and you just letting him do whatever he want to do. He says, send, pray that we send our laborers into the harvest. Because the harvest is plenteous. It's a whole bunch of people out there who do not have a shepherd. They don't have a shepherd. And Jesus said, he is the good shepherd. He is the good shepherd. Your love for people should move you to want to go help. See, and I ain't just talking about throw some stuff at them. That's not what we're talking about. It hurts me to see people just give folk who want to eat something some food, and they're not interested in helping their minds. To get them off the dope for real. To get them off the alcohol. To get them off the illicit sex. To get them off confusion in a home. It bothers me. And it should bother you. And they go through these religious days and religious motions, and they go to these religious churches, and the churches, I got 1,000 people in my congregation. How many you get? Yeah, but your whole congregation, don't nobody even want to obey God. They don't even believe in tithing, they don't believe in offering, they don't believe in walking in love, they still mean and honoring, they still throw the same pack of cigarettes they was 10 years ago, they still throw the same cigarette that you smoke. That's crazy. That's not God. God says, what did Jesus say? Let's go back and read it again. In verse 35, and Jesus went about all the cities and villages doing what? Teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. I believe in laying on of hands. I would love to lay hands on you and bleed to cast the demon or the sickness out of your body. But even if the sickness leaves your body and the demon gets it out of your body, if you don't replace it with what God's word says, I believe in God gonna heal me of diabetes, but you sit down and eat a fatback pork barbecue sandwich all the time. And you wonder why your diabetes is shooting through the roof. Wondering why you can't get your blood. You sit down. Man, I'm telling you, me and Lil Debbie, you know who Lil Debbie is? Lil Debbie Star Crunch, Lil Debbie Brownie, Lil Debbie Ho-Ho, Lil Debbie Oatmeal Cream Pies. I can sit down and eat 2 boxes of them by myself with a 6-pack of Pepsi. Blood sugar. This is not living. Head hurting all the time. stomach so bloated, heart doing this. Why your heart beating so fast? It's just the way I breathe. No, that's not normal. Well, what's normal to you may not be normal to me. See, don't come up with me with that religious stuff. If God, once God heals you and he shows you how to maintain your healing, because at some point in time you got to maintain it. You'll get healed. Oh God, praise God, I'm off the blood pressure medicine. And then you go back right down and get you a salt barbecue pork sandwich. It's like, come on. The pork, you can't eat the pork. George Burns, that man lived to be like 99, 98 years old. Never dealt with cancer, nothing. He smoked a big old fat stogie cigarette every day of his life. Every time we see him on TV, some of y'all ain't know who George Burns is. He used to have a big old cigar in his hand all the time and smoking them. But he never dealt with it. He just died of old age. Well, that might be me. On a wide scale, people, that's not normal. He's one of those anomalies where things just didn't happen. But for the most part, you sit down and you smoke something all the time, you gonna have something wrong. Something's going on in the mind that needs to be done. Now, guess what? I'm not gonna sit up and say I'm a psychiatrist, but because I'm not. I am not a psychiatrist. But I do know this. I know it's the word of God that's sharper than any two-edged sword. Dealing to the even, and that's Hebrews. Dealing even into the intents of the heart. Dividing of the soul and the mind. If you going to these psychiatrists and stuff, and they haven't dealt in God's word, and they just start pumping you full of medications, you need another type of healing. Look what he says. And I'm finna show it to you. I'm finna show you this. Come on. Finna show you this. Turn your Bibles to the book of Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy. Come on. I ain't got all this time. Deuteronomy chapter 12. Excuse me. Deuteronomy chapter 12. Watch this. We're talking about falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. Deuteronomy chapter 12. Look at verse 8. I'm not going to read this whole thing. We're going to come down to a specific point. This is one of these chapters where God is teaching the people about certain things that they should and should not eat. They should not eat. And how to clean it. Look at verses 15. Look at verse 15. Said Deuteronomy chapter 12. Did I tell you right? Come on. What are you doing? Deuteronomy chapter 12. Verse 15. He says, notwithstanding thou mayest kill and eat flesh in all thy gates, and whatsoever thy soul lusteth after, according to the blessing of the Lord, thy God, which he hath given thee, the unclean and the clean may eat thereof, as of the roebuck and as of the hart. And this is a type of animal. A roebuck, we call them deers. Okay, just in case if you don't know. You can go out and eat these different things based on the different hooves and the stuff that God called clean. But look what he says in verse 16. Only ye shall not eat the blood, ye shall pour it upon the earth as water. Notice what he said. Don't eat the blood. Go back up and I want you to read verse 13. Take heed to thyself that thou offer not the burnt offering. Wrong verse. Drop down to verse 22. Even as the roebuck and the hart is eaten, so thou shalt eat them, the unclean and the clean shall eat of them alike. Why is almost like he double talking, right? Look what he says again in verse 23. Only be sure that thou eat not the blood, for the blood is the life, and thou mayest not eat the life with the flesh. He said what? He said what? Don't eat the blood. What does this got to do with Jesus having compassion on people and me eating? Once you receive your healing, he's telling you different things that you should not do. Because if you go off and start doing these different things, everybody's different. Some people gonna have different effects to the body. You need to learn your body. You may need to listen to some doctors. You may need to read some books. My wife, if she reads us, and she reads something on a medicine bottle or something, or somebody say something, she'll Google it in a second. She'll look it up to see exactly what it is and say, okay, to offset this, if this is going on in my body, to offset this, then I need to do that. Or to get rid of this. The doctor was trying to tell me some time ago about my back. For a long time, I had to drop a lot of weight. Play a lot of football, a lot of Marine Corps, but the certain areas in my lower back where he says the moisture is not there. And I asked $1 million question. Okay, well, he said the reason why you're having pain in that specific area is because the lubricants are not there anymore. It's like moisture. It's like putting water there. And I said, well, I know I just can't drink a bottle of water and put moisture. I said, how do I get moisture back into that area? And he said, that's the $1 million question. Doctors are still trying to figure that one out. They're coming up with all these different surgeries. So right now, let's just work on strengthening and conditioning. Well, I understand it, but I'm still feeling the pain. I'm doing all these things, but how do I get the moisture there? If somebody else knows that out there, send the information to me so we can get the moisture back in these areas. But I know what scripture says. I know what scripture says. He healed all my diseases. He said his word is like health to my bones. His word is like health to my bones. Doctors may not know how to put the moisture there, but God does. God knows how to put the moisture in my back, in the joints and pain, in my body, whatever. God knows how to put the moisture in my thumbs. Glory to God. God knows how. But look what it says. But what he said in verse 23, do not eat the blood. And how many of us are turning right around and eating these red meats and they raw? Still full of blood dripping on it. What did he say about the life? What did he say about the blood? He said, the life is the blood. The blood is the life. The blood is the life. Hold on, Pastor. But don't we have communion? And don't we eat the body and drink blood? You are drinking the representation of the blood. Right? You're not drinking Jesus' physical blood, but you're drinking the representation of the blood. When you drink the blood or this representation of Jesus' blood, what are you doing? You're drinking the life that Jesus has provided for you. Y'all, that's an amen right now. Praise God. Jesus, hold your finger down. Hold your finger down. Go to John chapter 10. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Come on, Pastor. John chapter 10. John chapter 10. Look at verse 9. Look at verse 9. He says, I am the door by me. If any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out, and what? Find pasture. The thief cometh not but for to steal, and to kill, and to destroy. I am come that they might have what? Life, and that they might have it what? More abundantly. Verse 11, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his what? Life for the sheep. What life did Jesus give? He shed his blood. He shed his blood. He did what? He shed his blood for the remission of your sins. And every time you take communion, you are remembering that Jesus paid the price for your sins. Because Jesus had compassion. He saw us as having no shepherd, nobody to help us. That's what we said on Friday. Adam, he knew exactly what he was doing when he decided to disobey God. And he caused every last one of us to fall. Jesus says, that's not what I intended. So I gotta come and do it. He said, I am gonna be the representation for all mankind. Adam chose his own life over the life of everybody else's who was in line with him. I am choosing their lives over my life. That's why he gave his life over for us. He said, if I give my life over for them, they can have the life that I have, that I live every day in the kingdom, where there's nothing missing, nothing broken. Oh, God, doggone it, I got that, man. Man, that's some good stuff right there. Jesus, I'm giving my life. Go read. What was it? Go read in Luke. In Luke chapter 3, where Jesus was on the temptation or not temptation, and Jesus, Satan came and offered different things to him. He said, if you so hungry, won't you turn these stones into bread if you the Son of God, if you are the Son of God. He tried to come at Jesus the same way he came at Adam. Eat this food. Eat this. And that's what's getting us in trouble nowadays. Eating the wrong stuff. Yesterday, me and my wife, we was hanging out with all day long. We just having a good old time yesterday. And I don't eat pastrami all the time, but I had me a pastrami on rye sandwich, and it was good. It cost $11 for that sandwich. Y'all ever had an $11 sandwich? And it wasn't very, it was a regular old sandwich, but it was a good $11 sandwich with some fries. And I had a bottle of water to go with it, a little bit of old Pepsi, a little bit. You know, man, with made real sugar in it, so your body can burn it off. I enjoyed myself. But I know if I sit down and I eat a pastrami sandwich 5 days a week, and I turn right around and drink a six-pack of Pepsi and 18 Reese's, and then I don't do any kind of exercise, if I do that, I know blood sugar will be up here, blood pressure will be up here, and I'll be in the grave. Come on, people. Jesus said, I'm giving my life over for them so that they can have the life that I live in all the time. Glory to God. Watch this. Turn your Bibles to, where is it at? 1 John. Go back over to 1 John. 1 John. I ain't always going to go through all these scriptures today. That's the problem. That's one of the problems right there. 1 John chapter 5. Some of us, you need to go, you know, be bouncing these scriptures off of each other. You need to be going and reading them, getting them on the inside of you. I'm no exception. I have to read the scriptures too. I have to. 1 John chapter 5. Look at verse... What are you doing? 1 John chapter 5, look at verse 11. Look what it says. And this is the record that God hath given to us eternal life. Uh-oh. And this life is in his son. Ho, 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 ho. Wait. Are you trying to tell me, Pastor, that I have eternal life? That's what I'm telling you. Not just this everyday meager life that we live in here on the earth. Getting up, going to work, finding enjoyment time, watching a good movie. Yeah, those things are life, but I'm talking about actually enjoying every second of it. Every moment of it. Jesus says, I have come to give you life and give it to you more abundantly. He's given us this life. The life was in his blood. This life did not just provide enjoyment time every second of the day while you up here breathing, but it extends into eternal life. Eternal life. Death becomes a doorway. If you physically die right now, your spirit man, your soul man, well, if you're born again, you'll go straight on to heaven. They'll put your body in the grave, but you will still live on. You'll go in the glory. You'll hang out. That's why you never hear me say goodbye. I don't say goodbye. I really don't. I don't say goodbye anymore. I say see you later. Because in the kingdom, it's see you later. Ivory Senior, he died over 21 years ago. Was it 21? 22, almost 22 years ago now. 22 years ago. And guess what? He died in the kingdom. It's to see you later. I'm gonna see my earthly father again. He won't be my father in glory, but he'll be my brother in Christ. I'll see him again. Me and my wife, for some of you all who do not know this, me and my wife, when we first got married, we tried to have a child, and she had a miscarriage. She was a few months pregnant. And we don't talk about it too often. The only reason I'm talking about it right now, because it's connected to eternal life. See, we may not have physically had that child here on the earth, but that child was born inside of my wife. And guess what? That child now is hanging out with my daddy. And hanging out with my wife's brothers and sister. I mean, not brothers and sisters, because all her brothers and sisters, our older sister in glory, I believe so. And everybody else, her cousin, whoever else she had in her family, they all in glory. If they in glory, because I didn't get a chance to meet my wife, all of her previous relatives, but the ones now, they born again, we're going to meet all each other in there. And guess what? They hanging out together. And we'll see them again. We'll see them again. And then the words that you left here in the earth, the things that you set up here in the earth, people will still be living you out. What do you think we do with Abraham? We got the teachings of Abraham, Moses. These people, they're still living today in the lives of people. That's eternal life. Here I am teaching you about what Jesus did over 2,000 years ago. He's sitting on the throne right now. And he said, this is eternal life. You'll live. So let's get out of here. I had to stop and preach that for a second. Look what he said, verse 11 again. I really had to stop and preach that. That's good stuff. And this is the record that God has given us, eternal life. And this life is in his son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. So what's the opposite of not life? Death. If you just barely going through life, get connected to Jesus. If you struggle to get up out of bed. I have those days too when I'm like, but don't want to get up out of bed. I'm going to get up out of bed this morning. You know, he said, I mean, life to you. But guess what? I know I have life. Have life. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. almost sound like he double talking. He said, if you believe on the Son of God, you have eternal life. And this is the confidence. What is the confidence? That we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. According to whose will? His will. He says, if we ask him, we already have it. We already have those things. Why? Because he's already provided them for us. When he provided for us? When he shed his blood. We have them now. That's why Mark 11, 23 and 24 is so easily to grab hold to. Why? I have them now. They're already mine. Why? Because it's provided for through his blood. Through eternal life. The life is in the blood. Jesus lived it out. He became representation for all mankind. All mankind has eternal life available to them. And so many of us don't even know it. We go through life and we play this religious game. And people need somebody to preach and teach them the truth. So you trying to say, Pastor, that all your problems are solved? I ain't going to tell you that. But I can tell you this. I'm enjoying life. I'm enjoying life. And I'm free because I don't commit sin. I don't have to commit sin. He paid the price for it already. I have life. Once you realize that you have life, sin becomes like, I ain't doing that. And that's going to bring me death. I ain't doing that. That's going to bring sickness onto my body. I ain't doing that. That's going to get me involved in stuff that I don't really want to be involved in. I'm going to have to pay too much for that. I ain't doing that. That's not just ungodly. It's unlively. It looks like fun. But you have fun doing it. Some of y'all just do things just because it's fun. I'm having fun right now telling you that Jesus loves you, that Jesus shed his blood for you. I'm telling you right now, God paid the price for you. If this don't prompt you to love Jesus even more, we bind religious attitudes right now in the name of Jesus. We bind demonic spirits. People will see this new light. This light has already been made available for you. Praise God. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God. You're so good to us. You have provided eternal life for us in the blood of Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Hey, all of you all out there, remember, continue to learn how to follow Jesus Christ faithfully, holy, and holy. God bless y'all.